This lesson shows you how to use subscription databases in the most efficient way possible. Most of you are very comfortable Googling information and finding things online, but when you use the college's subscription databases, you're going to find much more in-depth articles and much more scholarly articles. And as you know, your easiest route of accessing this kind of material. Basically, the library subscribes to a service that gives you access to thousands of different periodicals. So subscription databases, even though you're getting into the database online, they are not really just websites. They are databases of articles that have been published in official journals and magazines and newspapers, etc. These databases are so huge that they can be a little overwhelming, so I'm going to show you how to be as efficient as possible when you're searching on them. To find them, you go to the Clark College website, you click on Articles and Databases, then you go over here. We're going to use EBSCOhost. ProQuest is another one that is very much like EBSCOhost. They have the same kinds of articles, but they do subscribe to slightly different periodicals, so it's worth searching both. The first thing you'll notice is you get the search box. So let's say I was interested in writing about eating disorders. If I were just to type in the topic eating disorders, I would get an overwhelming number of sources. It's 22,253. So this is where it becomes helpful to understand how the interface works. First thing you probably want to do is always limit it to full text. That way you won't simply get abstracts of your articles. You'll get the whole article. The other thing I would do, at least initially, to make sure that you can find enough scholarly articles on your topic, is limit it to scholarly or peer-reviewed journals. That also reduces it. We've reduced it by about half right now. I can go ahead and reduce it by date as well. So I can, in EBSCOhost, I just use the slider and I reduce it by date. And so I've got it down to 8,000 and some articles. That's still far too many, but part of the reason for that is that my topic is too broad. So one of the advantages of understanding Boolean logic is that you can use the Boolean operator and to limit the results of your search and also to narrow the focus of your topic. So let's say I wanted to write a paper about eating disorders and college students. Simply by putting in the Boolean operator and, I've limited the results to a narrower range of topics because I've chosen a narrower population to consider in my topic on eating disorders. So when you start looking at some of these, you notice some of them are from other countries. There are studies about the incidence of eating disorders in other countries. Some of them have to do with male college students. Some of them have to do with female college students. All of that helps you think about other possible ways of narrowing your topic. I usually recommend that you have 50 results per page. That enables you to scan more quickly. And while you might not want to look at 50 different titles, it's actually useful. At this stage in your academic career, 50 titles per page and looking at 361 titles is not a bad idea. You can also use the Boolean operator or. While the Boolean operator and narrows the results to the two terms, or broadens it to either of the two terms. So for example, I could type in eating disorders or bulimia, and I would get more sources than I had on eating disorders alone. So you use or to broaden, you use and to narrow, and you use the Boolean operator not to exclude. So I would do eating disorders and, let's say, male athletes, and then not female, and that's going to narrow it even more dramatically. We got 4 articles. So when you've narrowed it that much, sometimes it's helpful to eliminate some of the limiters that you put in before. So I would get rid of publication date limitation And I would probably get rid of scholarly at this stage too, just to see if there's some non-scholarly ones. You might also decide you want to get rid of the not limiter because realistically, some of these articles are going to talk about male and female athletes, and that might be useful to you. So if, for example, we looked at articles on eating disorders among male athletes and we got 19 sources, that's a nice number, actually. That's a good number, and I would feel comfortable going forward with that topic. So a couple of other quick things. Let me show you. I'm going to show you how to use the truncation symbol. That's an asterisk. If you replace particular sections of your word and words and phrases with asterisks, you're basically allowing the search engine to use any possible word ending from this asterisk point forward. So we have 19 articles on eating disorders in male athletes, but if we shorten it to disord asterisk and athlete asterisk, we'll get disordered eating and male athletes, athlete, athleticism, athletic males, etc. It doesn't usually add an enormous number of sources, but as you notice in this case, it did add 5. And because we only have 24, that seems worthwhile. Especially, let's see, that gives us 21 that are scholarly, which is nice. Any topic that has a lot of variations on how the word might end, like let's say physical education, is worth using the asterisk for. So if we type in physical education, we get 26,000 and some. Obviously, we're going to want to reduce by a year, at least initially. We still get a lot. This is actually not the kind of topic where you're going to want to use the truncation symbol because you're getting so many results. But if we did that, we would get physical educat, and we will get educators, education, etc., and it increases our results. So if you're getting limited results, don't hesitate to use the asterisk to broaden it out. If you're getting really unusual results, it's not a bad idea to put the phrase in quotation marks. So for example, if you were interested in eating disorders and male athletes. Okay, let's do that one again. We had, 13, because we've limited it to scholarly and the state. If we were to put the phrase male athletes in quotation marks, we're going to narrow it even further because what we're going to get is only those articles where that phrase is used in that order. So that would probably get rid of the female athlete articles, right? So that's another way of limiting it. So a couple of other things you should be aware of when you're doing a database search like this. Remember that this is a digital database, and if you spell something incorrectly, you will not get any results. Usually, if you spell it incorrectly, you'll get some suggestions down below. So it suggests, would you like eating disorder, eating disorders, etc. Sometimes, however, the spelling is a variation on an acceptable spelling. Maybe there are 2 or 3 acceptable spellings for a term. So you get just enough sources that you think you spelled it right, but not as many as you had expected. So let's go ahead and do ecstasy and addiction. So you're interested in researching the drug ecstasy and its addictive properties and the effects of the effectiveness of various treatment facilities, etc. So if you look, we haven't even limited it to full text. We limit to full text, we're going to get even fewer. We get 13 full text, and when we limit to scholarly, we only get 5. And if we unclick publication date, we're still only up to 6. So this is just enough sources that you might think you were spelling it correctly. But this is the British spelling of the term. The American spelling of the term and the more common spelling of the term uses an S there. And you can see we get 237 sources when we search for ecstasy spelled that way. Another possible, so if you get unusual results, see if there's a variation on the spelling. Make sure you're spelling it correctly. Let's do another one here. Sometimes a search term is frequently used as a, let's see, well, yeah, we'll go ahead and keep it full text and scholarly. Sometimes a search term is frequently used as a metaphor. So I'm going to use magic, and we're going to search for magic. And magic labelings of three regular graphs, Indian spices and Roman magic, magic and witchcraft, the magic of money and the magic of the state, fast money schemes in Papua New Guinea. You can see that the term magic gets used to refer to the actual science of magic or perception or the culture of magic, but also as a metaphor for something that's easy or fast. So sometimes, if you have a search term that gets used metaphorically, you have to put in another search term that's related to it that might reduce the results. So if we put in magic and perception, we get 87, and they are much more related to the topic that we're interested in. I had a student one time who wanted to write about tsunamis. And it was right after the Banda Aceh tsunami. Of course, now you'd get plenty of articles on the tsunami phenomenon after Japan's tsunami. But at that time, there hadn't been a major tsunami in recent years. And half of the articles he found were about the tsunami of smartphones entering the market, right? And so he had to put in tsunami and earthquake in order to get the results that he wanted. So this is a an important thing to be aware of, just making sure that you're using terms that affect your results in the right way. I'm going to show you one other example. Let's say you're interested in electric cars, and you're surprised to find that since, let's say, 2000, there are only 753 articles that are full text and in scholarly journals about electric cars. Well, sometimes we are using diction or word choice that is less common for a particular type of source. You might find a lot of non-scholarly sources on electric cars, but the scholarly articles are likely to use the phrase electric vehicle. And if we change the phrase to electric vehicle, for example, we get far more sources. So let's say you were interested in writing about a mental illness, okay? And you typed in manic depression, which is not really the typical term used anymore. It's a bit outdated. If you limited it by text, etc., we're getting more than I thought we would get, to be honest with you. But if we type in bipolar disorder instead, we're going to get far more. Manic depression is not the term typically used. We use the term bipolar now, and I think we'll get far more sources. And we did. We got twice as many. So make sure you're using the right term for the right audience and the right type of text. And this is a wonderful way to make use of the Writing Lounge. If you're not sure your search terms are the best ones, go to the Writing Lounge and say, hey, I'm writing about this topic. I'm interested in stream temperatures and salmon populations, and I'm not finding the right kind of sources. And maybe somebody who's recently taken an ecology class will say, hey, use the term riparian. That's what they use for streamside vegetation and water cooling. They talk about riparian health. And so somebody will be able to provide you with some vocabulary that might be more helpful in your search. I'm going to show you a couple of things real quickly here before we get too far out of EBSCOhost. You can see that this article, I opened up the PDF, and the PDF usually they have page numbers. This one in particular doesn't, so I'm going to go to a different version, a different article here and see what we can find. Let's look at this one. This is the same source, and it also is not going to have page numbers. I was planning to just sort of show off on how wonderful PDF sources are, but my effort to do that is not panning out. Let's go back and find some of the other articles on electric vehicles, perhaps. All right, let's look here. Here we go. Most PDFs look like this. We were getting things from a particular type of source before. And what you see, what you notice immediately, is that you have real live page numbers, which is really helpful. Remember, if you don't have real page numbers like these, then what you have to do is provide the paragraph numbers, which can be just really mind-numbingly dull to count. So when possible, try to open it up in a PDF version so you have access to that. Another thing I want to show you real quickly is this little button over here that shows you how to cite the source that you're looking at. When you click Cite This, you're going to get a long list of citation formats. So first of all, you have to make sure you find the MLA version. Once you do that, I want to caution you against simply copying and pasting this into your paper for a couple of reasons. One, they are not 100% correct and accurate. I have discovered that they are about 80% correct. For example, if you look at this, you'll notice it's not double-spaced. It also doesn't have a hanging indent. This has a Van Wee as the last name, so it's a little unusual, but it does seem to have the authors in the right order. The capitalization in the article titles is not correct. The I and the T and the F here should all be lowercase, as well as this I. The rest of this information looks pretty good. But what I would like you to be aware of is while this little Cite This link or EasyBib, any of these citation format help sites, are useful as a starting point, they're not going to be 100% correct, and that could cost you. 80% correct is what, a B minus, right? And you're all capable of being more correct than this particular example is. So make sure that you only use it as a starting point, and then after that point, you want to go ahead and try to perfect it yourself. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and stop this video, and then I'm going to start another one that shows you a couple of other search engines and databases that I think you'll find helpful. EBSCOhost and ProQuest are your first choices, obviously, but there are a couple of others I want you to be aware of. If you don't find many sources in EBSCOhost or ProQuest, then you'll definitely want to look at these other sources, which I'm going to talk about in the next video. And that's going to be CQ, Gale Virtual Reference Library, and some others that are really deeply buried in this section. But that's it for the Boolean logic benefits and efficiency. Let me go ahead and let you guys out of here.